My name is Adam Sandler. Instead of making jokes, I like to look into the camera and say, oh, 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 oh.
Are you an everyday nerd? Hit that subscribe button and turn on notifications so that you don't miss the next episode.
All right, so this idea was f***ing awful.
Y'all, welcome to your Everyday Nerd. I'm your host, Zach Steiner, and welcome to the first official annual Adam Sandler Week. That's right, Adam Sandler Week. Did you know when you subscribe to this channel, you'd be getting an entire week of Adam Sandler? That's right. For the first episode of the first annual Adam Sandler Week, we're going to be taking a look at the most nostalgic movie for me when it comes to these movies, 50 First Dates.
I work at an aquarium.
Aquariums make me super horny.
That's not funny. Don't rub those.
When it comes to the man, the myth, the legend, Adam Sandler, it's quite obvious that a lot of his movies are not good. In fact, this week alone, we're going to be talking about a couple that are just downright awful. But, surprisingly, oddly enough, in his treasure trove of films, if you want to call them films, Adam Sandler has a couple of movies that are good and enjoyable and entertaining. And in my opinion, 50 First Dates is at least some of those words. Now, I'm not going to say that 50 First Dates is a masterpiece, because it's by far not that. I wouldn't even say that it's objectively good. I think, in my personal humble opinion, I think that 50 First Dates is a good movie to watch on drugs. I'm just kidding. I personally like 50 First Dates. I watched it when I was a kid. I enjoyed it then. I still enjoy it now. Again, I don't think it's good. I think there's a lot that's wrong with this movie. But when I look at the entire package, there's just certain aspects that make me love this movie. And love is a strong word. And it's a strong word to say about anything, especially Adam Sandler movies. But I love this movie. And the main reason I love 50 First Dates is because of the chemistry between Adam Sandler and Drew Barrymore. For those of you that don't know, which is, I don't know at this point. Does anybody still watch these movies? I feel like we're out of the prime of the Adam Sandler movies, which is why this series is going to be so good in like 5 years. I'm so excited to do the fifth year of Adam Sandler Week and just hate myself so much. 50 First Dates is a movie about Adam Sandler falling in love with Drew Barrymore. Except, oh no, this is wacky and weird. Drew Barrymore has short-term memory loss. Every single day when she wakes up, she forgets the day that just happened before that. So essentially, she's living the same day over and 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 over again. All in all, this is an interesting premise to me. You have this guy, loves this girl, he has to go on 50 first dates in order to keep going out with this girl, in order to even get her to marry him one day. Is it realistic? I don't think so. I have a hard time believing that if I ever had short-term memory loss, some woman could just randomly come into my life and make me watch this movie every single day telling me how much I love her. I think she's crazy. I think I need a restraining order from her. It depends on how cute she is. Which is why I think this movie is even less realistic, because Adam Sandler is not exactly what you'd call a 10 out of 10. So, anyways, the charm of this movie lies in the fact that Drew Barrymore and Adam Sandler have movie chemistry. They are the perfect, and I would agree with this, they are the perfect movie relationship. They started working together back in the 90s with The Wedding Singer, which I will be talking about this week. And then another 10 years later, they were like, let's make another movie. So they made 50 First Dates. And then now every single decade, they make another new movie together. Their last movie was in 2014 with Blended, which I will be talking about this week, unfortunately. And they're planning on doing another movie in the next like 5 to probably 10 years. It's going to be cool. I'm excited for... But the one thing that all these movies have in common is that these two actors work really, really well together. When they fall in love, it's believable. And that's why I enjoy 50 First Dates, because as a rom-com, it does the romance well. Now we got to talk about the comedy. So this movie starts off with Adam Sandler being a pickup artist. And that's not believable at all. But I also completely forgot that this happens in the movie when I rewatched it. But yeah, he's like dating a bunch of different women. And then it just basically shows that Adam Sandler's character has commitment issues. So when he meets Drew Barrymore in a diner one morning for breakfast, Adam Sandler will be proud that I kept that burp in. It's kind of like confusing that this man is falling in love with somebody. That's really as far as it goes. These characters aren't exactly deep. It's a comedy. This is supposed to be a rom-com that you watch with somebody. I don't know. I watched it by myself. The comedy, if I was to give the comedy in this movie an arbitrary rating of 1 out of 10, I would probably give it like a 4. Like, it's not really that funny. There are moments that I chuckled at, like when this walrus pretends to have like a heart attack, then ends up throwing up on this one woman who is Adam Sandler's co-worker. Because, oh yeah, by the way, Adam Sandler is like a zookeeper for Arctic animals. His best friends are a penguin and a walrus. So I still don't understand how the hell he's picking up girls every night. Because the main source of comedy for any Adam Sandler movie is through its unique and wild characters. This cast has some really weird characters. The only characters that I'd say are like actually good are Drew Barrymore's character, because of this short-term memory loss thing. It works well. I like it. Her father, because he genuinely cares about her. He wants to like do good for her. He genuinely doesn't like Adam Sandler at first, but then he goes, you know, grows to love him like his own son. It's cute. It's heartwarming. It's nice. But then there's characters like Drew Barrymore's brother, whose entire shtick is he's like this little bitch that takes steroids. And he brags about it. And then there's this woman who, like I said, works with Adam Sandler, and she gets called a man like 5 times within the movie. Peak 2004 comedy, everybody. And then there's this couple who works at the diner that Drew Barrymore and Adam Sandler meet at. And like, the woman's fine because, again, she genuinely cares for Drew Barrymore. And she's like, Adam, watch out. You're going to hurt this woman, and we're not cool with that. But then you got like her husband, I think it is, who's just a guy that calls Adam Sandler Reese's Cups, because he likes Reese's Cups, I guess. Oh, crap. I just realized that he calls them Reese's Cups because it's product placement. That's another, what? I didn't even think about this. Okay, so when you watch 5 Adam Sandler movies, like literally back to back to back to back to back, you realize that product placement is a big part of it. And I watched 50 First Dates first, and I didn't even think about the fact that Elvis movie might have product placement. But it makes sense. At the end of the movie, you even see like a gigantic box of Reese's Cups. And Spam, it's another, this movie. So when I think about 50 First Dates, I think of a really cute romance. I love the way that Adam Sandler gets Drew Barrymore to fall in love with him 50 times. It's awesome. It's cute. There's some of that that's really, really dumb. But is this a good movie? No, it's not. It's a bad movie. Just like every single one of his other movies, pretty much. The comedy is just not funny. There's so many dumb things that happen in this movie just out of nowhere. And you kind of just have to deal with that. Fortunately, there's not as many dumb things that happen in this movie as there are in other movies we're going to be talking about this week. Which is why I'm not going to like list a bunch of examples of dumb shit that happens. Because for the most part, this is a movie that actually takes its plot and makes that the entire movie. As you'll see later this week, Adam Sandler movies have filler. So there we have it. 1 Adam Sandler movie to go. Like 50 more left. Like 50 First Dates. Oh boy. Guys, I just want you to know that I'm doing this. I don't know why I'm doing this. But here's the thing. I hope you guys will enjoy the very first annual Adam Sandler Week. We'll be back tomorrow to talk about Blended.
My name is Adam Sandler. Instead of making jokes, I like to put on a wig and act like a woman because that's what I do. It's funny how you say, you know what I mean?
That's all the time we have for today. If you like the video, go ahead and hit that like button. If you didn't, you can hit that dislike button. And let me know what you're looking forward to on Adam Sandler Week. I'll be covering them all week for the next 20 years. As long as he keeps on making movies, we'll be here. Go and subscribe for more of your everyday nerd. I'll see you tomorrow. Goodbye.
My name is Adam Sandler.
Blended, everybody. It's a movie that features Adam Sandler and Drew Barrymore, and it's a movie. Are you an everyday nerd? Hit that subscribe button and turn on notifications so that you don't miss the next episode. Yo, welcome back to Your Everyday Nerd. I'm your host, Zack Snyder, and today is the second official Adam Sandler video in the Adam Sandler Week of the Adam Sandler Week. What are we doing here? Let me tell you, this is the second movie to feature Adam Sandler and Drew Barrymore as they fall in love all over again, except this time it's in 2014 in the plains of Africa. I'm not joking.
We went to Africa?
Dad packs pearls, douches, fresh scent, medicated, and sweet romance. Yeah, let's not be doing the sweet romance douches quite yet. Poissy feminine wash. Poissy, that's a little close, guys. Always clean? I could actually use those. What's a diva cup? Is that to make coffee? I don't know.
What kind do you guys use?
So when I think of the five films, if you want to call them films, that I watched this week that feature Adam Sandler, this is by far one of the worst. There's one movie this week that I'm going to say is objectively good. There's one that I already said is not particularly good, but I still really enjoyed it. There's another one that's really bad that I still really enjoy. And then there's this one. It's really bad and it's kind of boring. And once again, the only reason you would want to watch it is because Adam Sandler and Drew Barrymore have really good chemistry. Like I said in the 51st Dates episode, every single like 10 years, these two get together to make a movie. And it's cute, it's nice, it's heartwarming. Except in this one, it's so blatantly obvious that nobody really cared about making this movie. Blended is about Adam Sandler and Drew Barrymore going on a blind date, only for that blind date to go horrifically wrong. For some reason, he takes her to Hooters, which we actually do find out. It's a plot device. It really is dumb why he brought her anyways, because he doesn't even look at her during the blind date. Instead, he watches TV, he drinks her beer when she goes to the bathroom, she gets something spilled on her, I think. It's just an awful date. And then, when she goes to tell her friend how horrible it was, and oh, by the way, Adam Sandler works at Dick's Sporting Goods, because it's funny to have a store called Dick's in the movie. It just makes all the sense. Oh, also, Shaquille O'Neal. He works at Dick's Sporting Goods, because celebrity cameo, everybody. Apparently, in these Adam Sandler movies, celebrity cameos just kind of happen. You kind of get used to a lot of like the Saturday Night Live personalities come on here, because Adam Sandler's whole shtick is, let me make movies with a lot of my friends because I used to be at Saturday Night Live, and that way I can give them a paycheck to just do an awful job at acting for an hour and a half. But there's also like these weird celebrity cameos, and I don't understand why. But I do love the fact that they're a thing. Shaquille O'Neal in the sporting goods store just working with Adam Sandler is the funniest I've ever seen. And it's ironic funny, because nothing in this movie is really funny. Things just kind of happen. So Drew Barrymore tells her friend that the date went wrong, and it just so happens that her friend is dating the guy that owns Dick's Sporting Goods. Also, Adam Sandler's a really good employee. So when this couple ends up planning to go on a family trip to Africa, and this woman ends up breaking off that trip because she didn't know he had kids, Mr. Dick Sporting Good himself ends up giving the tickets to Adam Sandler and his three daughters. That's right, he is a single father because his wife passed away. And the other tickets end up going to Drew Barrymore and her two sons, because her ex-husband is this guy from the show Community who's a dick. Not the one that owns the store. No, that's another dick. But that's the premise. These two families, Adam Sandler, his three daughters, Drew Barrymore, her two sons, end up going to Africa on a family trip. The gimmick is this trip was meant for the other original family to go to, so that they could do what this movie likes to call blend. Blended, and I love the fact that also Terry Crews is in this movie that sings about blending together. So I'm just gonna let him take away the singing thing. Go for it.
You are blending.
Finally,
yes, you'll be touching. Like wine and babooty.
Thanks, Terry Crews. So what ends up happening, LOL, this is quirky. The two families end up meeting together. They end up having to share similar rooms with each other. They end up having to go on like a bunch of the same trips and things together. Her boys end up really liking Adam Sandler as a father figure. His daughters end up really liking Drew Barrymore as a mother figure. By the end of the movie, they're inseparable. It's cute. I'll be honest with you. If the comedy in this movie was better, I think this could be a good movie. I kind of like the concept. Again, it's one of those cute rom-com things. And it's better than a lot of rom-coms, because a lot of rom-coms have a very cookie-cutter plot. This one's, it's interesting. It's unique. I like it. But once again, the comedy's awful. Things just happen out of no... It's f***ing weird. I don't understand why things just kind of happen in this movie. So they go to Africa, which right there is just weird in its own. Like, why are they going to Africa on this trip? Then there's this couple that's like this man who's probably like at least in his late 40s, early 50s, who's like married to this woman who's like my age. And then they have a son who doesn't want to look up to this woman as a mother figure, which I completely understand. I mean, like, this is a girl that you could literally go find at your college in 2 years. I completely understand it. But that's just like the tip of the iceberg as far as weird character goes. Like I said, shout out to Terry Crews and his little horde of people. I don't know. That was really weird. There's this dude that just keeps on calling Adam Sandler really long, like, winded last names because...
Silly Theocropolis. Mr. Belly Flopolis. Hi, Mr. Theocropolis. Are you ready, Mr. Chia Pedalis?
Gently, Mr. Lollipopolis.
He's supposed to be showing up as Mr. Dick himself. I don't remember. This is dumb. Why am I doing this? Why am I making videos about Adam Sandler 5 in a row? This takes no sense. Sorry, it got real there for a minute. I didn't mean for that to happen. One of the worst parts, though, for me, was the fact that Adam Sandler's character in this movie is just, like, he's just an awful human being. I mean, yeah, he loves his daughters and he takes care of them, and that's nice. That's sweet. I love that kind of stuff. He even, like, goes out of his way to help Drew Barrymore's sons, and she does the same thing with his daughters. It's cute. It's sweet. It's heartwarming. But, like, what man truly loves his daughters if he names one of them ESPN? Espen. After the ESPN, the sporting, the network on team. The other daughter, he named her Larry, and she looks like, she's played by Bella Thorne, which is kind of funny because she kind of went crazy. But like, she looks like a dude, and so like this entire movie, you just keep calling Bella Thorne a guy, and she cries about it because she has a boy haircut, and it's like, okay, that makes sense. But it's like, it gets to a point where we're only two Adam Sandler movies in. What are we? Is Blended a good movie? No. Is it enjoyable? No. Is it boring? Yes. Is the chemistry between these two actors really good? Yes. Is it worth watching for that? I don't think I'd go that far. If you're in the mood for an Adam Sandler movie marathon, maybe watch this along with 50 First Dates and The Wedding Singer, because they're both in that. Maybe. But if I could have gone my entire life without watching Blended, I think I'd be just a little bit happier today. But that's all we have for today. If you liked the video, go hit that like button. If for whatever reason you didn't like it, you can hit the dislike button. Let me know down in the comments what your favorite thing about Adam Sandler is. I'll use that for my videos next year, because I'm recording these back to back. I don't know if you could tell yet. I don't know. Anyways, go ahead and subscribe for more Everyday Nerd. I'll see you tomorrow. Every time I start recording a video, I start the audio, and then I say, starting video recording in 3, 2, 1, click. I said click this time, I kind of chuckled because this video is about click. That's my opening joke. If you didn't like it, f*** off. Are you an everyday nerd? Hit that subscribe button and turn on notifications so that you don't miss the next episode. Yo, welcome to your Everyday Nerd. I'm your host, Zack Snyder, and welcome back to the infamous, unusual, exciting Adam Sandler week. That's right, everybody. Clap it up for Adam Sandler week. I know everybody's excited. We're here. We're live. We're proud. Today, we talk about the movie that's probably the most famous Adam Sandler movie, besides his quote-unquote good ones out there. And it's Click, everybody. It's motherfucking Click. If you're not excited for Click, then I don't know who you are.
What the hell's this room made of?
Pizza.
Well, it's stupid.
Next.
You're not my dad.
Eh? As far as you know.
What?
I was just joking.
Is it really my dad?
Now, I first watched Click back in, like, when it came out. I don't remember when it came out. But I watched it. And you know what? I enjoyed it back then. I rewatched it again today for the first time in years. And you know what? I still enjoy Click. You know why I enjoy Click? Because it's such a... You're going to hear this a lot in these videos. It's such an interesting premise. This one was actually executed quite well. Now, is the comedy in this movie good? Take a guess. I'm gonna put up two answers on the screen. And you got 30 seconds to answer. Do 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 up, ba do 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 do. I know this sounds awful. I'm gonna sing it anyway. Do you have your answer? Ba ba dum bum bum. No. Click features Adam Sandler as a man who's unhappy with his life. He has a hot wife, he has two children, and he works as an architect. Now, being the guy that he is, his issues are quite abundant. He wants a promotion in work, but it's taking too long. He argues with his wife over stupid stuff. He has his parents that he doesn't really want to come around to his house. And that's pretty much it. So, one day, he realizes that out of all of these issues, the thing that he's most angry about, the thing that he's pissed about, is the fact that he doesn't have a universal remote control. Yeah, me too. I didn't quite understand why he was so pressed on having a universal remote control. Apparently, it's because he had like 30 remote controls all around the place and he needed something that would universally control them. Today, we do have a universal remote control. It's called our phone. We can use our phone to turn on our TV. We can use our phone to turn on our car. We can use our phone to turn on our phone. It's incredible. So he goes to Bed Bath & Beyond, and there's a little gag where it's like, Bed. Bath. Beyond. But he goes into the f***ing store, and he sleeps on a bed because he's exhausted from architect work and arguing with his wife. And then he goes to Christopher Walken, everybody, who need more cowbell, gets a motherfucking remote control for him for free. This dude just gives him a free remote control and he's like, here you go, man. Here's the solution to all your issues. And lo and behold, we find out that this remote, that's aptly named Click because of this movie, ends up being a remote control to anything, life, everything. He can fast forward life. He can pause life. Put on subtitles. He can make himself green. This is my favorite scene right here in the movie. So here we have Adam Sandler, who's exploring the usage of this remote. And on his way to work, he's irritated about traffic, so he fast forwards traffic. He slows down because there's a hot girl jogging or something. And then in his like parking lot, he's messing with it, and he realizes, I can change my skin tone. I can change my color. Now, fortunately, Adam Sandler was smart enough to not write a joke where he made himself black. I'm glad he didn't do that. Because honestly, I'm quite surprised he didn't do that. Do I think that'd be funny? Absolutely not. Do I think that'd be racist as Absolutely. Am I very surprised that Adam Sandler didn't do that? Yes, I am. Instead, he turns himself green and makes a Hulk reference. And then turns himself purple. It seems the theme song to Barney, the purple dinosaur. It's lovely. The kids love it. Adults love it. Nobody loves it. Anyways, so the issue with Click in Michael's case, because his name is Michael. I actually remember his name in this one. The issue ends up being he ends up fast forwarding a lot of things that happen in his life. When he fast forwards things, he doesn't actually actively become a part of those things that he fast forwards. So he ends up missing a lot of his life. And it ends up being a sad movie. He had a wife and kids and a job, but he wanted more. And that more ate into his soul. And he ends up actually becoming more. He ends up being really fat. He got more of everything. And then he has surgery from being fat because he gets like a heart attack. Because he was fat. And then there's this scene.
That's not bad for your third liposuction. One more tummy tuck should take care of it.
Well, it looks like a tongue licking.
Look, I should go. Bill's waiting for me downstairs.
Bill! You still with Speedo Torpedo?
One more tummy tuck should take care of it.
Well, it looks like a tongue licking.
Look, I should go. Bill's waiting for me downstairs.
Bill! You still with Speedo Torpedo? Whatever happened to forever and ever, honey?
Forever and ever.
Licking.
One more tummy tuck should take care of it. Look, Michael, I'm trying to have a civilized relationship with you for the kids' sake. I really want to be friends, but I can't do that if you... Would you stop flapping that thing?
Licking. It's my flap. I'll do whatever the hell I want with it.
You done?
I hate this scene. I don't like it at all. The only reason I'm showing it is because I gotta show you what's bad about this movie. Now, what funny moments are there? Well, I like any time where he ends up like messing with his boss, who, by the way, is played by Forgot his name.
David Hasselhoff.
He ends up like pausing time and farting on him. That was kind of funny. There's this dog that ends up humping a stuffed duck a lot of the movie. It wasn't funny. I just thought I'd have to point it out there for you. There's, again, with these movies, there's just like a lot of random stuff that happens. Now, I will say one of the things that I enjoy about this movie, there's not as many dumb characters. And that's very, very nice. It's a lot of these movies. There's just these really absurdly dumb characters. I forgot to talk about how bad Rob Schneider's character is in 51st Dates. Okay, so you know what? You know what the one thing I really hated in 51st Dates? It was the fact that Rob Schneider was in it. Why is this man allowed to act? Why is he making movies? He's not funny. He's annoying. He's apparently in other Adam Sandler movies. I'm gonna have to watch this dude, Rob Schneider, in other movies. His last name is similar to mine. Snyder and Snyder. It's not fair. Anyways, back to our schedule programmed click. Click. Such a good movie. How many minutes are we into this recording now? Yeah, about 9 minutes. A little cursor just hit 9:11. Click is a movie that's fun for the whole family. If you're gonna watch any Adam Sandler movie with your family, I think Click works. A little bit, there are some adult jokes in there that maybe you shouldn't show your youngest kids, but I watched this as a kid somehow. I don't know, there's so many movies I wasn't allowed to watch. I don't know how we ended up watching this one, but I liked the premise as a kid. As an adult, I still like the premise. I think that it is executed pretty well, actually. The problem just ends up being that Adam Sandler's not particularly funny. There's not really anything you laugh at except, you know, actually, you know what? You know what's great about these movies? You're not really laughing with the jokes. You're laughing at the jokes because they're so bad, it becomes funny to watch happen. It's just how it is. So do I recommend Click? Yes, to a certain extent. It's such a bad movie that I think it's kind of good. And I know that I watched it with Aiden from Blue Couch Productions, one of my good friends recently. We watched it and he hated it. He said, this isn't a good movie at all. But you know what? I made him watch part of another Adam Sandler movie, and I bet he thinks that one's a lot worse. So, 3 down, 2 to go. We'll be back next week, next time, tomorrow, for another Adam Sandler movie and Adam Sandler week. Get hyped. But anyways, that's all the time we have for today. If you like the video, hit that like button. If for the reason you didn't like it, hit that dislike button. Let me know down in the comments what your thoughts about these movies are. And I will catch you tomorrow. Bye. Hey, what's that? Is that an actual good Adam Sandler movie? That's crazy. Are you an everyday nerd? Hit that subscribe button and turn on notifications so that you don't miss the next episode. Yo, welcome back to Your Everyday Nerd. I'm your host, Zack Snyder, and today is more Adam Sandler Week. Is everybody having fun on the first annual, the 2019 Adam Sandler Week? Because I am. I'm having fun. I'm enjoying my... Where's my muscle relaxers at? Hold up a second. All right, cool. So now that I've done some drugs, we're back. We're ready to talk about the only film I've ever seen with Adam Sandler in that I would call an objectively good movie. But it all was bullshit. Crap. It was a heckin' joke. And when I think of you, Linda, I hope you freaking choke. The Wedding Singer came out in 1990-something. It features Drew Barrymore and Adam Sandler once again. This is the third one I've talked about with them three in it, and it's the only three movies that they're in. And this is the very first one. This is where it started it all. This is where the chemistry of these two actors start on the screen. And I have to say, it kind of shows. Like, when you get into 51st Dates and Blended, their chemistry is so good together in those movies that, like, in The Wedding Singer, watching this one last, it was kind of a little bit disappointing. It's not bad. In fact, it's still pretty good. But it's so clear that these two characters or these two actors know each other so well in future movies. That in The Wedding Singer, it's like, yeah, I believe this. Like, it makes sense they fell in love. But not to the extent that I felt in Blended, which is an objectively awful movie compared to this. What The Wedding Singer does well is that while it still does have some of those, like, Adam Sandler tropes that are bad, like dumbass characters, like this old woman that keeps talking about Adam Sandler's penis multiple times, she was bad. And there's some other bad characters, I guess. But what it does well is that it has, like, an actual plot that is followed through the entire movie. There's no filler, like some of these movies have. It's literally just a rom-com. It follows the same beats as a traditional romantic comedy does. And there's actually funny stuff in here. There are actual funny stuff in here. And I think it's because Adam Sandler gets depressed. And I think a depressed Adam Sandler makes for a funnier movie. I'm not gonna lie, that sounds a little hard, but let me tell you this. How many videos of mine have you watched where you said, he looks like he's in pain? This is really funny. My Titans video. My Fallout 76 video. My Pokemon waifus video. These are all moments of darkness. I hated myself when making those videos, but you laughed. You thought it was funny. And I understand, because when Adam Sandler goes up on a stage and he starts screaming about wanting to kill himself in front of everybody, it's the funniest shit. And I've never laughed this hard at a movie with this man in it. At this one particular scene, it was the funniest. I should probably talk about the plot. The Wedding Singer is about Adam Sandler as he's a wedding singer. He sings at weddings. He's about to get married. And it just so happens that when he gets on his wedding day, he's been excited for his wedding day his entire life. But when he gets up there at the altar, she doesn't show up. And then he becomes depressed and he quits singing at weddings. And through all of this process, he ends up meeting Drew Barrymore, who is about to marry somebody as well. It just so happens that the dude that she's about to marry is he's a dick. He's an asshole. Nobody likes him except for her for some reason. He's got a lot of money, so her mother is like, hey, you should marry this dude because he got a lot of money. And it's like, that's just how it be sometimes. Probably when I'm going to find somebody, I have a lot of money, I'll be like, hey, girl, I got a lot of money. And they'd be like, all right, let's go. Let's get married. I'm just kidding. I'm not going to let anybody know when I have a lot of money. I'm going to find a girl that loves me for me. I'm not even going to say how much money I got. In fact, I'm going to make her pay for the first day. That's how you find true love, boys and girls. That's how you do it. Anyways, Adam Sandler's upset. Drew Barrymore's, she kind of upset too. They meet each other. They're like, hey, I kind of love you. They end up kissing randomly because, like, Drew Barrymore's friend is like, hey, have you practiced kissing for your wedding day yet? And Adam Sandler just happens to be there. And she's like, why don't you just try on him? And so they kiss, even though I don't think this would ever happen in real life. And then, like, 5 minutes later, Drew Barrymore's friend is like, I think I'm going to date him. And then she tries to with Adam Sandler. And he ends up, like, saying, no, I can't do that because I actually like Drew Barrymore. And it's cute. It's a good movie. I really like this movie. I would definitely watch it again. Out of all the Adam Sandler movies I watched this week, I think this is definitely the best one of them out of the five that we're talking about this week. I don't think it's quite my favorite. I think I like 50 First Dates a little bit more, but it's definitely up there. It's still got a lot of charm to it, which is nice. But anyway, that's all the time we have for today. If you liked the video, go hit that like button. If for a reason you didn't like it, hit that dislike button. Let me know down in the comments what your thoughts about The Wedding Singer are. It's a good movie. Go check it out if you haven't already. And tomorrow, we're talking about Jack and Jill. I don't want to talk about Jack and Jill. I don't ever want to see this movie again. Why?
Are you an everyday nerd? Hit that subscribe button and turn on notifications so that you don't miss the next episode.
Well, welcome back, you everyday nerd. I'm your host, Zack Snyder, and today is the last day in 2019's Adam Sandler week. We're talking about a movie that I thought I had never seen before, but then apparently I repressed it. We'll get into that in a bit. I've now seen this movie 3 times. It's Jack and Jill, featuring Adam Sandler as the titular character Jack, and featuring Adam Sandler as the other titular character Jill.
I'm sorry, Jack. The Dunkin' Donut people want to talk to us. Okay, well, I got it. It's gonna be fine. Yeah, you'll take care of that. Thank you very much. I didn't need that, but cool. I got some bad news. We may lose Dunkin' Donuts. What do you mean lose? They didn't like our pitches? They want Al Pacino. Al Pacino to do a commercial?
Mm-hmm.
The Godfather Al Pacino. They have this new coffee drink, the Dunkin'chino.
Uh-huh.
Dunkin' Chino, Al Pacino, they sound alike. Yes. Well, they think it'll be a home run. Of course it would be a home run. If he would ever do it, which he won't.
Well, never say never. Remember, you didn't think we'd get Brad Pitt to do that Radio Shack commercial.
I was right. Well, you can't be right all the time. Look, bottom line, they're going to give us 1 month to make this whole Pacino thing happen, or they're going to go elsewhere. We can't lose Dunkin' Donuts. They're our biggest client.
Damn it.
We're going to go bankrupt, buddy. We have 200 employees relying on us. Try to have a good Thanksgiving, okay?
Jack and Jill is about Jack working in a advertisement agency. He needs to get Al Pacino to do a commercial for Dunkin' Donuts. Unfortunately, Al Pacino won't do the commercial for Dunkin' Donuts unless he can get a date or I guess a relationship with Jill, Adam Sandler's fraternal twin sister. Unfortunately, Jill doesn't want to be with Al Pacino, so Jack dresses up like Jill. Adam Sandler dresses up like a woman to act like a character that's Adam Sandler dressed up like a woman to go on a date with Al Pacino so that Al Pacino will do the commercial for Dunkin' Donuts. But then Al Pacino realizes that Jill doesn't love him, but he wants her to be with somebody that he loves. And Al Pacino does a commercial for Dunkin' Donuts anyways.
Everyone wants my Dunkachino. Can't get enough of my Dunkachino. Kids from 7 to 17 lining up for my Dunkachino.
Meanwhile, Jill is a character that nobody loves except for Jack's wife and kids. His wife is played by Katie Holmes. Because I don't know why she's in this movie. I feel sorry for her. I don't know why Al Pacino is in this movie. I feel sorry. I don't feel sorry for any of them. They get a lot of money from this movie. Nobody loves Jill except for Jack's family. Jill's been alone her entire life. So she goes on a date with somebody. But then that's not important to the movie. What's important is that Al Pacino likes Jill. But Jill doesn't like Al Pacino. But Jill does find true love in Felipe. A Mexican that's racist against his own kind. Jack and Jill was made in 2011 and is what I would consider the worst con in movie history. Adam Sandler decided, let's make a movie with 20 of my Saturday Night Live friends. None of us will be good in it. None of the jokes will be funny. Nothing will be funny. I'm going to dress up like a woman just because it's a kink of mine. Haven't done it outside of the bedroom. Let me put it in a movie. And they make this movie and they got money back. They made their money back. He paid a bunch of his friends a big whopping $1 million check to star in this movie. He got like a couple $1 million out of it. And they put out Jack and Jill, and we had to pay for it. So when I was researching Adam Sandler Week, I knew that I wanted to see 50 First Dates again. I knew I wanted to see Click again. I'd never seen The Wedding Singer, and it's a classic, so I figured I'd watch that. That's 2 out of 3 Drew Barrymore Adam Sandler movies. Let me go ahead and watch Blended. Okay. And then the 5th one was like, I don't know what I'm going to watch. And somebody recommended Jack and Jill. And I said, okay. I've never seen this movie, so at least maybe I'll get a little bit of entertainment out of it.
Yeah.
Honey?
Yeah?
Try complimenting her.
Yeah, what?
To avoid fighting, just focus on something positive. Tell Jill that she has nice shoes.
Then I started watching the movie, and the first scene happened, and I was like, man, I'm having these strange deja vu vibes.
Well, I can't find him anywhere. Does he know what terminal it is? Okay, I see him. All right, I'm hanging up.
How we doing?
And the second scene happened, I'm like, wait a second. I feel like I know what's going to happen in this scene.
Anyways, Joe, I was thinking.
Yeah.
The house is going to be very crowded because we got the kids and all the guests are coming by and blah, blah, blah. So
I watched the third scene and I was like,
hey, I'm a gun!
I feel like I know what's going to happen throughout this entire movie. And then by the fourth scene, I was like, wait a second. I've seen this movie before and I don't know how, I don't know when, I don't know where, but I've seen Jack and Jill before. Somehow my brain, I had PTSD from seeing this movie. I had repressed memories of seeing Jack and Jill, and I still, to this day, have no idea how I've seen this movie.
You can Skype us anytime you want.
I don't even know what that means. What is Skype? It sounds anti-Semitic. What is it?
I wouldn't have watched this with my parents or my family because it's not a good movie, and they wouldn't pick this awful of a movie to watch. I wouldn't have watched it with any friends because why would any of my friends have the taste of a monkey and decide to watch Jack and Jill? I wouldn't have seen this on my own because the only reason I watched this on my own now was to make a video out of it. I just don't understand where, when, and how I watched this movie, but I've seen it before. And that's saddening to me. So in order to recoup these memories, after watching it for brand, like, again, I decided to watch it for a third time. And I tortured my friends Jay and Aiden by putting this movie on. Aiden fell asleep halfway through it. I still don't know when or where I've seen this movie. It's not okay. The movie's not good. Every single scene just happens. There's an entire, like, 4-minute scene of Jill coming to the family dinner table with Jack. It's Jack, it's Katie Holmes. It's his two kids. One of them, which is his daughter, who dresses up like American Dolls the entire movie. The other kid is an Indian boy that he adopted, and then Jill gets mad because the Indian boy's Jewish because Jack's Jewish. LOL. Anti-Semitic jokes. But he's Adam Sandler's Jewish, so it's fine. He's got his mother there. I think it's his mother. I think his father's there too. And then there's a homeless man named Otto for some reason. There's just a homeless man. It's Thanksgiving dinner, and this just happens. There's just like this scene for like 4 minutes, and the only funny part in the entire movie does happen in this scene, because it's like this Indian boy knocks the f*** out of Jill, and it's the funniest thing ever. But it's like, why is this scene happening for 4 minutes? So, again, the entire plot is, let's get Al Pacino. We may lose Dunkin' Donuts. We can't lose Dunkin' Donuts. Let's get Al Pacino in a commercial, because it's Dunkachino. So they get Al Pacino to be in the commercial by the end of the movie. But my favorite part is how Al Pacino meets Jill at a Lakers game. Jill doesn't like Al Pacino. He shows up at her birthday party. Jill doesn't like Al Pacino. Jill decides to go on a blind date with some dude off of like Match.com, EveHarmony.com, FarmersOnly.com, ChristianMingle.com, Soulmates.net, that's what it was. And so there's like an entire 15 minutes of her signing up for this website, not getting matches. Adam Sandler like makes up about her. She goes out on a date with this dude, and then he ends up Spider-Manning his way out of her life in the bathroom, which is kind of funny, I guess, whatever. And then she gets sad because the dude didn't like her. Because she is Adam Sandler in a wig. Nobody wants that. And so Al Pacino tries again for her. And instead she goes for Adam Sandler's Mexican gardener, who just continues to make these racist jokes about himself. He's like, you're better than I can't do the voice. He's like, you're better than when I jumped the border. I'm kidding. That's his line. That's what's all funny about him.
I'm kidding.
They go to like this Mexican like party, and his grandmother's there, and she's like the ugliest thing in cinema history. And you find out that it's just Felipe dressed in drag, because that's what Adam Sandler's been doing this entire movie. But this scene happens, and then we get David Spade in drag at the end of the movie, and that's just the most awful thing I've ever seen in my life. I never want to see anything like that again. This movie, I just don't understand it. I'm ending it. Thanks everybody for watching. I hope you guys enjoyed the first official Adam Sandler week. We'll be back next year, February, baby. Subscribe for more Your Everyday Nerd. I'll see you in the next episode. If I don't kill myself first.
All right. So this idea was f***ing awful. Here I am. It's the end of the week. We watched 5 Adam Sandler movies. And honestly, I don't know how on earth I could do anymore. 50 First Dates, I still enjoy it. Click, you know, it's got some moments that I liked. It's not good, but I enjoyed it. The Wedding Singer, it's a good movie. It's very solid. Lots of people can enjoy this movie. Blended. Why? Jack and Jill. Where's my f***ing knife?